Hallelujah. God is good. You know, it's just a great song. He's good. He's perfect. His ways are the right way. You know, and we think about how good God is, you know, we should move away from all the concerns that we have and realize God's going to take care of it. I see that so often in our life as I study the Bible, and I realize, you know, that's really a cry of his heart. Just, I want my people to believe me. Believe my word. We was out of town visiting relatives in Missouri. And of course, Wednesday was Halloween. And one of the my nephew's little girls, it's really touched me. She dressed up as a gift, as a present. She was a box, you know. She had it wrapped up like Christmas. I said, what are you? She said, I'm a present. I thought, wow, isn't that powerful? I'm a gift. And I thought, I remember saying, you are a gift. That's right, you are a gift. She was just so happy. And that's what we are, a gift. Just think about that. You know, think about that. What for God? What has he done for you? That's what we always got to remember. You know, and our gift back to him is how we use our life. And our life starts with acknowledging him. That's where we got to start at. When we think about how good God is, we ought to start our prayer off every day with thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You know, it's nothing wrong to have prayer requests and all that. There's nothing wrong. But praise makes all the difference. The Bible said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. His praise, not our complaint, not our concern, but his praise. And that's what happens. We get all, what if God don't come through? What if he don't come through? What makes you think he don't come through or he won't come through? All right? Did he come through all the other times? I'm telling you, God is good. God is good. And God, he's good. Yes, he deserves it. He deserves it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. In Jeremiah 31, I usually put title on the sermon so I can remember them years back. But today it's like, you know, I was thinking about God's love. Remembering God's love. Yes. To never forget how much he loves you. You know, he cares about you so much. I'm telling you, when he sent his only begotten son to die for you, to make that, while we were yet sinners, he loved us. He died for, think about that. Not because we was good folks, because we were away from him. Can you imagine that? I'm always get awed by really devout Christians. They had the Apostle Paul, they had the movie Apostle Paul, and we was watching part of it. And what got me is when the Christian was going to be, it's a hard scene to watch, but they was going to be fed to the lions. Yeah. And the gate, they had a gate that goes up. And it was amazing to me. They panned in on, it was kids in there. I mean, it was all different groups. And as that gate comes up, you can hear the lions on the other side. And they just kept their gaze on the Lord. It was like, okay, if this is the way it's going to be, I'm still trusting the one that's going to take care of me. And I just watched their face. They wasn't screaming. They just, it's like, if this is the way it's going to be. And I thought, what about total submission to God? You know, we was talking about this the other day, is that sometimes, you know, your partner may hear that God wants to do this. You may not be comfortable with it and everything. But I said, you know what? It doesn't matter. They heard from God. And it's up to us to be obedient to that call. The best Christians I've ever seen are ones that God said, I want you to do this. I'm doing it.
Yeah.
I'm doing it. You know, because Moses, you think about Moses, were you going to go back and tell a Pharaoh, let people go? And Moses, well, I can't speak well, and, you know, I can't do this. And it's like almost God got frustrated. Who gave you your mouth, Moses?
Yeah.
You know, just do what I ask you to do. Hey, your brother Aaron's coming. He can speak well. He'll go with you. He'll be your mouthpiece. You know, but what I'm saying, and they do, well, I can't do this. I can't do this. Sure you can. That's why I'm going with you.
Yeah.
You know? You know, you ever notice that? You can't lead a person to a place unless you've been there first. And God's already been there.
Yes.
You know, we hear this a lot that, you know, don't worry about tomorrow. God's already there. We worry way too much. Yeah. You can't go forward and backwards at the same time. You end up in the same plot. That's the only thing that's happened to you. You ever try walking forward and backwards at the same time? You're just going to do this. No, God wants us to walk forward. You know what? Jesus said, come follow me. But if you're following somebody, they're walking ahead of you.
Yep.
That's what you always got to remember. He said, you know, God's saying this. We say today, I know I talk about it a lot, but God's got this. I got you.
Yes.
That's what he wants you to know. I got you, no matter what your concern is. Hallelujah. God's good. Let's get fired up here. We got a reason to be fired up. God's good. This is an Amplified version. I love the way the Amplified version is. Jeremiah 31, verse 3. We've heard the verse before, but I like the way it expands it. The Lord appeared from old unto me, Israel, saying, yes, I love that. Yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Again, it's an Amplified version. Yes. You got that? Yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn you and continued my faithfulness to you.
Yes.
Think about that. God is faithful, all right? Look back on your life. That's why it is good. You know, Donnie, talk about when they set up the stones. When you do that in your life, I write a lot of stuff in my Bible, and I write prayer requests and stuff, and you go back and you look what God has done, how he answered them. It's good to have those monuments in your life. You know what? God did this for me at this point. You know, I was down there visiting my brother, and one of my relatives had come through. I hadn't seen him for years and years and years, but he told us he had cancer, so we're going to pray for him. But what I loved about his attitude is that he had some other illness, and God took care of those. You know, he said, God's going to take care of this.
Yes.
His attitude was like, no, why does that happen to me? I didn't see that at all. I saw a light in his face.
Yes.
Said, you know what? God's going to take care of this.
Yes.
God's name. Jesus' name is above every name. As the Bible says, right? That's above cancer.
Yes.
Right? It's above heartache.
Yes.
It's above brokenness. It's above all those things.
Yes.
Hallelujah. It's above me losing a job. It's above me having some issues with my kids. It's above all that. That's what we got to always remember. Is that the way God wants us to think?
Yes.
You bet it is.
That is.
That's the way he wants us to think. You know, sometimes, and it's so true, I'm glad Suzanne thought about, we do have an issue, you know, we worry so much about what other people think. That's one reason some people won't serve the Lord the way they should. Oh, what if I do something wrong? What if I do, so what? You know, there's nothing wrong with mistake. Like I say, I teach driving, and one of the things about teaching somebody to do something, it's all right to make a mistake. One person said this, you know what, Tim, got to remember, tell them everybody had a first day. And no matter, everybody had a first day. It's not about being perfection, because there's only one perfect. It's about being progressive. It's about getting better. You should be a lot better to Christian a year from now than you are from now. Right now, because why? You're getting closer to God. You should get closer to God every day. You want to make that walk. When God says, yes, I need to do this, yes, I'm doing it. I'm going. I just feel that this. He wants us to be obedient. The Bible says obedience is greater than sacrifice. You know, we can give him money. Now, hey, I want you to do this. I want you to go lay hands and pray for this. Just, oh, I don't know if I go over there.
Yeah.
I remember years ago this, and he had a, this individual, he did have a really bad reputation. I mean, he had a temper and everything. And God wanted me to go pray for him. Now, let me tell you, that was hard. I was young in the Lord. And he had a bodyguard. Bodyguard was ugly, let me tell you. I'm just saying, he looked at y'all mean, and I walked up to him, and you go pretty hard.
Yeah.
You know, so I went up to him, and I said, I like to talk so-and-so. What do you want? What do you want him for? I just want to talk to him. And the guy heard me, and said, just let him through. Let him through. Whew. I was glad of that. So I went up to him, and said, sir, I hate to bother you, but I really feel the Lord wants me to give you this. And I have the Bible tracts. And he wants to tell you how much he cares about you. Mm-hmm. You know, and he loves you. Mm-hmm. And you know, he looked at me and he could have said, what are you doing? You crazy or something coming in here? He said, well, I've been thinking about that. Wow. Huh? Mm-hmm. Does God know how to get people together?
Yes.
You know, I didn't know he was thinking about it.
Yeah.
You know, I've been thinking about that seriously.
Yeah.
You know?
Well,
I, you know, and I didn't have, the conversation didn't dwell too much. It was, I did my part, I feel, you know.
Yeah.
You know, but I feel that, wow, you sown that seed.
Yeah.
Somebody sowed it, and you come and you watered it,
yeah.
You know. I don't know what happened the rest of his life, but you know what? You can't go wrong being obedient to God.
No.
You cannot go wrong.
Right.
You know, when we think about how good God is and how that, you know what? You know, you know, people say, well, Tim, how do you know it's God or devil? Come on, brother.
Yeah.
You really think the devil's going to tell you to go pray for somebody?
Yeah.
You really think the devil's going to tell you that? I want you to go buy groceries for this. You really think the devil is selfish? He don't care about nobody, right? He's not going to say that. But, oh, you know it's God. Hey, I need you to go witness to this person. I need you to call this person up. And, hey, I want you to invite him to church. You'd be surprised. That's some reason people don't come to church. They just need one person to come and invite them. That was it. That's how I became a Christian, because one of my cousins came up and he says, Tim, they're having revival for the young folks. Do you want to go to church? Now, as we got older, he slept every day when he was a kid, but got older, he was sporadic. You know, he may come a week later, you know, so I figured if I say no tonight, but I'll come, you come back the next day and I'll come, I figured he probably wouldn't come back, but he came back the next day. I said, no, I keep my word. So I went to church with him, and I'm telling you, that was a life-changing event. I don't remember what the preacher talked about all night long, but I know what he talked about that got me from the old Tim to the new Tim. He talked about the blood of Christ.
Yeah.
That blood covers it all.
Yeah.
You want to change, let that blood cover it all.
Yes.
It reaches from the lowest valley. Remember that song?
Yes.
To the highest mountain, that blood covers. I don't know. He said, Tim, I don't know what happened to you, but I know that the preacher had a handkerchief, and he come toward me like that real slow. And when I pointed contact, boom, he said, you almost fell out of your knees. I don't remember all that, but I know that there was a change that took place.
Yes.
You know, I was still 6 foot, still overweight, you know, still a big guy. But you know what? The inside.
Yes.
The inside had changed.
Yes.
That's where God starts you.
Yes.
He starts on the inside. I remember going home, and I'll share this before, but I remember going home, and Mom thought, what in the world's going on in that room back there? Man, I remember taking a garbage bag, going to the room, throwing everything out that didn't please God. I was cleaning house. Let me tell you, and that's where a lot of us need. Let's get rid of all that stuff that does not glorify God. Anything that we shouldn't be watching, looking at, talking to, or whatever, let's clean house. Because you know what? One thing that God wants is those who worship Him in spirit and in truth. And the thing about that, doing that, is to always be truthful with God. If you're struggling with something, that's what I love about my angel the most. You know, because she just bears it out there. You know, that we don't have to talk like King James people. We just talk, just bear it out. You remember, and I want to go to the story of the woman with the issue of blood. To me, that's one of the most fascinating stories. The one with the issue of blood. Okay. And that is found in Luke chapter 8. Now, the one thing I like about this story, Luke chapter 8, it occurs after, early in the chapter, we know about the gathering demon act. We understand that. We all read that story. But I'm going to start in verse, let's go ahead and start in verse 38, Luke chapter 8, verse 38. Again, it's the Amplified. And we know how Jesus delivered the demon act. We understand that. But let's start in verse 38. And it's going to end with that part. But the man from whom the demons had gone out kept begging and praying that he might accompany him and be with him. But Jesus sent him away saying. Now he delivered him. Okay. But look what Jesus wants him to do. Return to your home and recount the story of how many great things God has done for you. Let's have a testimony. That's what we're talking about. God delivered you. Go home and tell them all about it. Look at that. And the man departed, proclaiming throughout the whole city how much Jesus had done in him. Think about that. Went home. That's what, the best testimony. Now, people like to say, they can argue doctrine all the time. They get this point and this point. But you can't argue with that.
No.
They know the guy was in the tomb. They know who he was. He was scaring a lot of people, I'm sure, to hear him crying and cutting and all that stuff. And to see him now in his right mind. And he's going out proclaiming Jesus. You can't argue with that. How are you going to argue? That was him. That guy used to live up. Yeah, that was me. But Jesus healed me. That's what happened. That's why I'm in my right mind now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So he's out there preaching. I'm sure he's telling everybody wherever he's at. Hey, this happened to me. Because that's what Paul did. So many times. You know, I think about Paul. He could have got wrapped up in all the stuff. Persecuting Christians, killing. You know, he could have got wrapped up in all that. But he said, you know, on the road to Damascus, something happened to me. I fell down. And he'll say, what am I supposed to do, Lord? He was knocked off. You know, Paul, you don't get it. See, you think you're prosecuting Christians. You're prosecuting me because they're my people.
Yeah.
You think I'm just letting you touch my... No, he said, wait a minute. You know, you deal. That's what I say. When people start getting God's people, God's going to deal with them.
Yeah.
God's going to deal with them. You can't just poke. You keep poking and poking. Yeah. God's going to deal with you.
Yeah.
You know, but what God did, you ever notice? You know, Paul had enthusiasm for what he was doing wrong. You know what? God didn't take that part away. You ever notice that? He didn't take his zeal away. He just redirected it. Now, Paul, you persecuted those, but now you're going to start proclaiming to those people out there that Jesus is Lord. And that's what Paul did the rest of his life. He told them, this is the way I used to be, but now I'm redeemed by the Lord. That's what happened to me. I got a testimony. And everybody went, he'd always share that. God is good. He wouldn't dwell on the old Paul. He started talking about the new Paul. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, when we look at this, that he had proclaimed, and now when Jesus came back to Galilee, verse 4, the crowd received and welcomed gladly, for they were all waiting and looking for him. Now, when Jesus came back to, and there came a man, he's walking back to the city, came a man, Jairus, who had for a long time been a director of synagogue, and falling at the feet of Jesus, he begged him to come to his house. Fidel had one daughter, about 12 years age, and she was dying. As Jesus went, the people pressed together around him, almost suffocating him. Now, y'all been to ball games, we all go to ball games, and there's a lot of crowd. I used to work at them. And you may have 60,000 people, and they're all good. But you know if somebody reached out to touch you in that crowd versus somebody just rubbing up against you, you know, just kind of through the crowd. But there was something different here. And the woman, now think about this. Always think that, you know, she might have heard, you know, that this guy, that all the demons had went out preaching. She might have heard this, right? Because it lines up in the time zone, right? He might have heard this, that, hey, wait a minute. You know, hey, there's a guy out there preaching that God delivered. Maybe this is the same God that can heal you of your issue of blood. What do you have to lose? She didn't have nothing to lose. It wasn't working her way, because we look down in here, for it had, and the woman who had suffered from a flow of blood for 12 years. Can you imagine? 12 years, and she spent all her living among the physicians and could not be healed by anyone. Can you imagine that? 12 years, constant. You know, and if you ever had any blood issues, and I've been in the hospital, you know, they don't smell good. It's just a lot of sickness around that person. I know sometimes the family kind of get tired. 12 years is a long time, a whole decade of that. You know, I'm just like, wait, Jesus is coming. This one that healed him, maybe if I could just touch him. Maybe that's, I don't even want to talk to him. Maybe if I get close enough to him, some of that heal will rub off or something.
Yeah.
Now, again, she had this crowd. Now, look, I just think about this. This is so, she's going to go through the crowd. I don't care what the crowd thinks about me. I'm going to go all the way. I'm going to go touch Jesus. That's what I'm going to do, regardless of the crowd. I'm going to go in, and that's where we got to press through so many times. Because this person said, well, you can't do it. You don't have the education. You don't have this. You don't have the upbringing. But no, maybe I don't have that, but I got Jesus. That's all I need right there. Hallelujah. That's who I need right there. You know, I'm on the home team. I'm the win team right there. Hallelujah. And cannot be healed by anyone. No, there's no way. From an earthly standpoint, can you imagine you spent all your money? You don't have nothing. You can't go to family. I'm sure she went to family. Can you please help me? Hey, we don't have any money. And she done. That she come to the end. But it's never the end with Jesus Christ. Because the Bible said he's the beginning and the ending. The Alpha and Omega. People say if you come up to the end, oh, that's too bad. Come in. Said, no, that's good. Because the end is Jesus.
Yeah.
The Bible says he's the Alpha and Omega. Right? The beginning and the ending. So you're still in the right place. You can't lose. Hallelujah. And he came up behind him and he touched the fringe of his garment, and immediately her flow of blood ceased. Immediately the healing took place. You know, it wasn't, she didn't have to wait no longer. And I'm sure she felt the body, something's going on here. Wait, the blood stopped. Whoa, look at this now. And Jesus said, I love this. You know, Jesus says, who is it who touched me? Now, the disciples were just ordinary men. You know, they you know, and they're just saying what we'd probably all say. Hey, you got 60,000 people all, and they're pushing up against you. When all were denying it, those who with him said, Master, wait a minute, don't you understand? The multitude surround you and press you on every side. They're all around you. Who touched you? Probably this person. No, they don't say. But Jesus said, see, you don't understand. You're still thinking about earthly part.
Yeah.
See, I'm a heavenly being. I'm man, but I'm every bit God. Yes. That's what you got to understand.
Right.
I got healing power in me.
Yes.
And I'm telling you, there's something different right when she touched me. But Jesus said, someone did touch me in a different way. For I perceive that healing power has gone forth for me. That's what we need to do to get healed.
Yes.
Is right there. We need to touch Jesus.
Yes.
I know, I tell you what, he can use the physicians. He can use all that. I guarantee you, he can work through them.
Yes.
I've had surgeries, and God, what I love about surgeons is sometimes you get somebody in there that I'm going to tell you, they you know they belong to Jesus.
Yes.
The nurse, you know they belong to Jesus.
Yes.
We'll take good care of you.
Yes.
God will watch over you.
Yes.
You know, they don't take me through the Roman road map, but you can see, hey, they believe. They believe God is using them. More power to you, brother, right there, because God is going to flow through them. And I'm a standing testimony that God healed through them too. Now, let's say in here, and that he perceived that healing power has gone forth from them. And woman saw that she had not escaped notice. Oh, wait. Jesus turned around. Wait a minute. Oh, somebody touched me. And she couldn't escape. Now we're found out. But I loved that. And when the woman saw that she had not escaped notice, she came up trembling.
Yes.
Oh, man. Boy, yes. He saw me now. I wanted to kind of go in and get healed and kind of go out. You know, yeah, I just want to kind of get out of the crowd. No, wait a minute. There's more in store for you.
Yes.
It's not just the healing on the outside, right? We're going to have some healing take place on the inside.
Glory.
Hallelujah. That she came up trembling, falling down before him. Now, I love this. I love this because now she declared in the presence of all the people for what reason she had touched him and how she had been instantly cured. You know, that's where we got to come to. You know, that you know, there's times we just need to give it all to the Lord.
Yeah.
You know, in Hezekiah in the Bible, when the armies was coming up, the Bible said he went to the temple and just spread everything out for the Lord. And that's what we need to do. Hey, Lord, this is the situation I'm in. This I'm not trying to hide nothing. Because how can you hide something from God?
You
can't hide from God. You might as well bare your heart. Hey, God, you know, I'm struggling with this. You know, I understand.
Yeah.
The best thing a person saying, I understand. I've been there. But you know what? Hey, I've been on the other side too.
Yeah.
I've been on the victory side.
Yes.
You can get through this.
Because
you know what? I'm with you.
Yeah.
I am with you. You know, I really love it when I see, it could be an older brother or a younger brother, when he takes him by the hand and walks him across. There's a brother, it got to be a little brother in the neighborhood. We live, and he gets hold of that little boy's hand everywhere they go. He just holds that boy's hand. I mean, as they walk on the streets and car, he just holds his hand. I thought, what a picture.
Mm-hmm.
He cares about that little boy.
Yeah.
Man, think about that God holding our hand.
Yes.
You think about him. The Bible says he rejoiced over it with singing. You know, I just think about that. The little girl that was a gift in the box, we went to the house and she came straight out to me. You know, she just went straight out to me. And you know, you just pick her up and she's so precious. And you realize, you know what? This little girl, God has a plan for her life.
Yes.
Jeremiah says, as he said, 29:11, you know, give you a future and a hope. That little girl was not born in vain. There is a plan for that little girl's life.
Right.
And the best thing we can do is pray for them.
Right.
If you have a child that's not walking with the Lord the way they should, don't give up on it.
No.
Don't give up on it.
No.
There's always hope.
Yes.
You know, there's always hope. Think about that. You think about that. You know, people think, oh, I don't know, man. They're too far. How can you possibly say that when you think about the thief on the cross?
Right.
Now, I'm saying that's cutting pretty close, but I'm just saying, you know, it can still happen. Like we had an individual, hadn't heard from that individual for a long time, and, you know, you have a lot of issues emotional, and they call us up, and, you know, and Facebook got some good things, too, you know, because they do put some godly things on there. But they, you know, this message comes up. How you doing? I talk about out of nowhere. That's how you doing, you know. And I'm thinking, wow, you know, God opened that door back up. What are you doing tomorrow? We're going to church. You know, and they're more than welcome. And one Sunday, we're going to look for them coming here and bringing their daughters to church. That's why I say we never give up on them. You never give up on your kids or your grandkids, because I'm telling you, you know, the Bible says, you think about Paul planted, Paul's water, but God gave the increase. That our job is just to go out. We don't know which step we're going to be. Sometimes it's just watering. Sometimes you're going to reap. All of a sudden, wow, that person wanted to come to Christ. Well, you think, oh, I'm a big shot. No, you're not a big shot. There's other people along the line that have watered and planted. I never forget this. And if I share something that I did before, I'm sorry about that, but it's still good. But I never forget being over at the 284 over at the world's biggest truck stop. But they used to have a Dairy Queen across the street. And this was in the middle of summer. You know how busy Dairy Queen is, right? Yeah. And there was a young lady behind the counter. And it wasn't for that time I was in there. It wasn't crowded. People wasn't out there. But I really felt, it was just on my heart that I need to share the gospel with that lady. Young lady. She was probably in her 20s, early 20s. I need to share it. And I had just went through the program, Evangelism Explosion. It had come out that time. And so I asked her questions, and it was like she didn't know where she's going to spend eternity at, why she'd get to heaven. And it's funny. This is how God works. I ordered my food, and nobody came in that door till I finished. Now, in the summer, this is summer there, nobody came in that door. And I said, would you like to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior right now? You know what she said? Yes. And I took her hand and we prayed right there at Dairy Queen. And I saw a light inside her. I mean, her life was changed. It wasn't just, well, you're saying this to be. No, she accepted Jesus Christ. And I said, I'll be praying for you. So, and then as soon as that was done, the people start coming in. And the Lord spoke in my heart, wait, you can't just leave her because she's a babe in Christ. You can't just leave her. Well, I go back and forth through here. Said, what do I need to do? I said, you need to call a pastor in the area that will come out and make sure she gets in the church and make sure she grows. I said, wow, I'll do that. So I went and called. I just got in the phone book, kind of went down there, and you kind of felt drawn to a certain pastor. And guess what? He was home. He was home, his office or wherever he's at. And I talked to him. I said, sir, it's not important for you to know my name. Important is there's a young lady, and I had her name tag. She's out here at Dairy Queen after exit 284 and crossing the world's biggest truck stop. I said, she just received Jesus Christ. I need you to come out here and make sure she gets in the church and she grows. Get her a Bible and help her get on her way. And she said, he said, I sure will. I'm believing that. I believe. I never saw her again, but I believe that one day I'm going to meet that lady in heaven. Why? Because when you're obedient, God will make so much happen. Yes. Sometimes we miss those blessings when we're not obedient. Now, I know we struggle, and sometimes we get to the point where, well, I don't know, God, I messed up on that. Let's try it next time. Let's try it next time. To where you just say, I surrender all. Yes. I surrender all. Yes. a pastor once told me, says, Tim, do not sing that song, have thine own way, unless you mean it. Don't be singing that song unless you really mean it in your heart. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way, I have on my being absolute sway. That, Lord, you control me. The Bible says we're supposed to love the Lord God with all of our heart, all of our soul, every part of us is supposed to love God. Now, I'm going to look at this. Verse 47, Luke 8. And when the woman saw that she had not escaped, notice she came up trembling and falling down before him, she declared in the presence of all the people for reasons she had touched him, and how she been instantly cured. I love the way Jesus talks to people. I just absolutely love that. And he said to her, daughter. Boy, I mean, that's just a touch of tender way. Daughter, your faith, your confidence and trust in me has made you well. Isn't that tender? That's absolutely such a tender way. Go enter into peace. Untroubled, undisturbed, well-being.
Yes.
Isn't that a powerful section right there?
Yes.
Right? She wasn't just healed from the ailment she had. She was completely healed from the inside out.
Yeah.
Can you imagine she walking away? And I mean, a new light in her. Guess what God done for me? You know, guess what? No more doctor bills, you know? I can go back and they declare me, you know, a full bill of health now. I'm going to praise God. And I tell you what, we don't know, because at the end of the Bible, you know, it says a group of women follow him. We don't know who all they were, but it's hard to think she wasn't one of them. That and the rest of her life, she was praising God. Because you know what? This way I used to be. 12 years I was like that, but no more. Hallelujah. I said every day I can praise God. I tell you what, he gives me that peace that the world can't understand. That's what we always got to want to. This woman understood that. I'm going to go through the crowd. I'm going to keep on pushing. And no matter what they might say, I can't do it. But God he don't stay in the I can. He stays in the I can. And he says, today, harden not your heart. Come to me. That's all I ask you. Come to me. Hallelujah. 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 The one thing that I love about God is that we always got to remember how much he loves us.
Yes.
And one of the things that I want to go back into Deuteronomy chapter 7. Deuteronomy chapter 7. Hallelujah. Go in the Bible and just read about love all day long. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 7 and start in verse 6. Hallelujah. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6. Again, it's the Amplified version, so it'll read a little different. Verse 6. For you are a holy and set apart people to the Lord your God. I love this. The Lord your God has chosen you. Isn't that magic?
Yes.
You know, when we was playing, you know, pickup football games and stuff, you know, there was always the kids nobody wanted.
Right.
That's true. They picked the good kids, the big kids, play football, and then mom come out there, so you got to pick that person. You got, you know, they got to play too. They didn't want to pick them.
Yeah.
But think about this. God has chosen you.
Yes.
Think about that. That you are chosen.
Yes.
He wants you. He wants you on his side.
Yes.
He loves you.
Yes.
He said, God has chosen you to be a special people to himself out of all the peoples on the face of the earth. Verse 7, the Lord did not set his love upon you and choose you because you were more in number than any other people, for you were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loves you, and because he would keep the oath which he swore unto your fathers, the Lord has brought you out with a mighty hand.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And redeem you out of the house of bondage from the hand of the Pharaoh, king of Egypt.
Yep.
Know, this is verse 9. Know and recognize and understand, therefore, that the Lord your God, he is God.
Yes.
We cannot forget that.
Woo.
He is God. There's only one God.
Right.
Okay? There's only one God. There's only one way to him, and that's through Jesus Christ. There's only one. You know, people tell me, oh, you know, Tim, all roads lead to Rome. I've been driving a truck a long time. And I know if I go east on 80, I will never reach California. So don't tell me all roads lead to the same place. They don't. There's only one way, and that's Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He is God, the faithful God. There it comes back in, the faithful God. Who keeps covenant and steadfast love and mercy and with those who love him and keep his commandment to a thousand generations. Now think about that. A thousand generations. And I was looking up that and see what we look about as a generation. And they look at generation, it's like 30 years. The people are in the same place. Now think about that. 30 times a thousand, that'd be 30,000 years. It's just an unending amount. You know, it's an unending amount. 30 years equal one generation times a thousand. It's just an unending. His faithfulness does not end. Think about that. Think about how good God is every day to you. Even if you have a bad day, as long as you're with Christ, it's still a good day. Even if you have a heartache, the things that go on, you know what? It's still a good day. And maybe you got a few aches and pains, but you know what? You can be in the hospital. Right? Okay? Maybe you don't have the job that you want, but you still got a job. Maybe you're not eating the food that you'd rather eat, but you still got food. Hallelujah. Maybe your bills don't get paid always on time, but they get paid. That's what we got to always start looking at. We got to look at the fact God is still faithful. And that's what he wants us to do, is to trust him constantly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, oh, hallelujah. God is just so good. God is so good. Psalms 116:12. Psalms 116:12. Hallelujah. 116:12. Okay. Hallelujah. And this is from the New Living Translation. I'm just going to read out the New Living Translation. What can I offer the Lord for all he has done for me? That's the New Living Translation. It's going to be a little different. What shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits toward me? What can you give God for all he's done for him? How can we possibly repay him? You know, I always think that when it comes to the Lord, you know, since he was willing to die for us, then surely we can live for him. That is the best testimony you can give. It's to live for the Lord every single day of your life and say, God, you know what? Today's going to be better because I'm with you. You want me to share the gospel? I'll share the gospel. You want me to pray for these people? I'll pray for these people. That's why when God lays somebody on your heart to go see, it's probably a good idea to go see them, because we don't know where they're at in relation to eternity, right? That may be their last day. I went down there. We went down to Columbia. I remember one of my cousins had stopped me. This was years ago. And he always called me, Timmy, would you come over and see me? You know, I know you're a Christian. I just like to talk to you. You know, we get busy and, you know, sure. And I didn't go. And he passed away. And I thought, I wonder what he wanted to talk about. Maybe he wanted to get his life right with the Lord. I don't know. But you know what I said? I'm not going to do no more. I'm not going to mess up those opportunities. Because I'm telling you what, sometimes people know their time may be getting short and they want to get things right. They want to get their life right with the Lord, because you know what? I tell you, they're, when you go out of this world, there's only two places to go, right? Yeah. Either upstairs or downstairs, right? Yeah. That's it, heaven or hell. You know, we're not going to be suspended between the two. It's heaven or hell. We're going to either be with Jesus or not be with him. And we want, you know, the thing about heaven, just think about it. Sometimes you can see the clouds, and sometimes it looks like you see people's faces in it, and sometimes you see like Jesus that you think about. But I always think about heaven is a place that you never have to leave anymore. That you can see your loved ones forever and ever. You can spend. The best part is to be able to spend it with Jesus and just say, thank you for all you've done for me. And you never have to leave. You never have to worry about being kicked out of there. You know, you're up there because you want to be and he wants you there. Think about that forever and ever and ever. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is so good.
Yes.
And the last one I want to turn to is actually in Revelation. I'm going to go to Revelation chapter 2. God is good, folks.
Yes.
God is so good. Revelation chapter 2. Okay. Gets the right one here. Yep, 2. And I'm going to start in verse 3 and 4. Now, this is when, you know, it's the revelation of Jesus Christ, but John is writing things down. But and he talks about the different churches. But this is the church of Ephesus. Now, I'm just go down here to verse 3 and 4. Because this is what we're talking about. We're talking about love. Verse 3 says, I know you are enduring patiently and are bearing up for my name's sake. You have not fainted or become exhausted or grown weary. But he has this one charge. Just think about this. And this is where we always got to be. But I have this one charge to make against you, that you have left, abandoned the love that you had at first. That's where we ought to be, that you have deserted me, your first love. You know what? Remember then from what heights you have fallen. Repent. Change the inner man to meet God's will. That's what it's about. Think about that. Our first love always has to be Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. Loving him no matter what. Mm-hmm. Even when there's difficult situations. We was just talking about that the other day. That some people, what they do is when they're in a hard place, they'll run to God. You know, the God, get me out of this. God, get me out of this. God, get, you know what? He gets them out of it. You don't see him no more.
Yeah.
Okay? That's not the kind of relationship you want. You want a constant relationship so that you, when you go to God, you don't have to reintroduce yourself. You know, hey, it's been a while since I've been back to talk to you. No, you want to have a constant relationship so that you know God's going to come through. Hey, God, I'm bringing this to you, but you know what? I know you're more than able to handle this situation. You did it before, God. I'm just lifting this situation up, and I'm already going to praise you in advance for it being done. I'm not going to wait till the answer comes. I'm just going to go ahead and praise you. That's what he was saying to Moses. You know, that they come up to the Red Sea. What a difficult situation. You got all these people coming out. You can see the dust of the Egyptians back in the Red Sea, and they're crying out to Moses, "Hey, you bring us out to kill us out here? What are we supposed to do?" And Moses crying to God, tell them to go forward. Go forward. How can they go forward when they got a Red Sea before them? Hey, listen, all they need to do is be still and see the salvation of the Lord. Yes. See me open up. Because you know what? That Red Sea means nothing to me because I created the Red Sea. I can tell it to part and the Red Sea will part. And that's what happened. It stood up. He stood up this way. He stood up. And they went clear across on dry land. It didn't wait to time frame that, you know, this muddy down here. I tell you, it was dry land. Yes. And the Bible says every one of them passed through. Every one of them passed through. They got to the other side. I said, you know what? God can open the Red Sea, whatever you're going through in your life. He can do a miracle. One day I was coming up 235 and just some things going in life and said, I need a miracle, Lord, you know, in this situation. You know, hey, Tim, wait a minute. You know what? I deal in miracles. I am the original miracle worker. That's what I can just trust me. Just as all I ask you to do is trust me. Don't doubt. Trust me. I understand you have questions. You know, people say, well, my mom would say, Tim, you shouldn't ask why. You know, ask God why. Shouldn't ask why. And I thought, well, why not? I mean, you know, there's nothing wrong with asking. He says, Tim, all you need to do is just remember that God is good to you. And whatever happens in your life, he's working all things for together of good. All things. So what if this situation doesn't work out the way you thought? You know, man, I had my idea on this house right here. God, it seemed like just a perfect house. I can afford it. And God says, no, the finances fell through. And we get that bottom lip hanging out there, you know. You know, we all cry and get that bottom lip. Well, God, what happened? Wait. Wrong attitude. Wrong attitude. The right attitude is, okay, God. I don't understand this, why it fell through. But God said, you know what? I got something better for you. Man, I can get you a better house than that. Because you know what? I need you to be in that neighborhood because the neighbor next door needs to hear about me. So I need you to move you over here. That's what I need to do. Just trust me. I'm a lot smarter than you. I understand what's going up. And I'm looking at eternity. I'm looking at the picture. I lived up here on 8th Street years ago. And there was a lady that went to my church. And she came and knocked on my door. And he said, Ben, who was a house down from her, he said, Tim, would you come to the hospital and pray for Ben? He's dying. He's 86 years old. Would you come to the house? Okay? Now, what are you supposed to do? Well, you know, I'm kind of busy today, ma'am. You know, this is not a good time for you to come. I'll put it off tomorrow. You know what you do? You go down there with her.
Yeah.
That's what you do. Yeah, and I thought, well, if I had moved in that neighborhood, the way the circumstance was, and she knew I was home, she'd come up there at that time, see how God orchestrated. And we went down there to the hospital, over here at Methodist Hospital, and we prayed. Ben couldn't talk. He couldn't talk. You know, we were just sharing the gospel with him. Now, I don't know where he was all at spiritually, and she said he didn't understand the Lord and all that stuff, but we prayed with him. And all I saw was a light in his eyes.
Yeah.
That there was something that happened in Ben's life right there. Right there. Because we was obedient and God came through. Yeah. That's what I'm talking about. And you know what? Ben died a couple days later. And you know what? I'm looking forward to seeing Ben one day in heaven. Hey, Ben, you know, I was your neighbor. Oh, was you that guy that came over there and prayed for me that day? Hallelujah. I want to thank you for coming and praying because I went out knowing Jesus. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Folks, being obedient is where God wants us to be. Even when it's uncomfortable, even when we think, God, this doesn't make sense. It doesn't have to make sense. A lot of things in the Bible, they don't make sense when you look about how he wants to do things. But God has a way of letting it work out. He has a way of working out. That's why the Bible starts in the beginning God. It doesn't start once upon a time like a fairy tale. Because it's a real book. It's a real Bible. There was real people in there. They had real struggles. You know, David had a lot of struggles. But I always like that, you know, David was identified a man after God's own heart. Now you can look at it a couple of ways. That he had a heart like God, or he was after God's heart. He wanted that heart of God. He always wanted to do that. Yeah, he messed up in different things and areas of, but you know what? David would cry out. He eventually realized, I messed up, God. I messed up, God, and I surrender. How many people have been blessed by Psalm 23 through the years, you know? Because David understood something, you know what? That he needed God in his life. No matter, I cry out to you, create in me a clean heart, Lord. A clean heart. Because I want to be able to serve you with a clean heart and a good heart. Oh, Father God, today, thank you, Jesus. Thank you that we can pray today. Thank you the fact that you love us so much. Let us never forget. Let us never lose our first love, which is loving you. Hallelujah. Let your love become predominant in our life. No, hallelujah. No matter what may be discouraging, realize that you are encouraging. You are a God that is always on our side. You love us with an everlasting love. The Bible said you never leave us or forsake us. In Psalm 37:25, David said, I was young, but now I'm old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken or seed begging bread. Oh, Father God, it is all about you. You are good. Good, as the song said, so good. Let us never forget that. That you are God. Hallelujah. The wonderful Father. The mighty God. The mighty Counselor. The one that will take our lives and turn them around from the inside out. The ones that, Lord, you want to use us in a mighty way. To see others born into the kingdom. That's why we are here at this point of time in history. So we can affect what's going on. Affect the world. Hallelujah. They used to say that you know, these are the disciples. They turn the world, you know, upside down. No, it's the other way around. They turn it right side up. That's what needs to happen right there. That it needs to get right side up. And the only way that's going to happen when Jesus comes first. Hallelujah. Oh, Father God, thank you so much that we can come in your house today. Thank you that you touch every single life that's in this building today. The ones that couldn't be here, Lord, that you touched their lives and let them know Jesus Christ is Lord.
Yes.
Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to give you the glory.
Yes.
We got to give you the praise.
Yes.
In your wonderful holy name.
Yes.
We pray amen and amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
That's it.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
That's it. Thank you all.
Thank
praise the Lord. God's good.